So if there are any questions, once again, please ask. We are here to make sure that we fill in all the blanks or anything that you have. So please go ahead and ask questions.
Hi, Rahul. Avril here. Hey, the programming in these examples or this project is in C or Python or which language?
Oh, Avira, that's a great question. So the programming is in both C++ and in Python, and you can pick either one, whichever you are more comfortable with. And at the end of each of these, parts of, that I just mentioned over here, at the end of each of these, Johannes will walk through the coding part of it. And we'll actually go through the code and understand how the code is written, so it becomes much more clear. But that's a great question. We want to be very practical and teach you how to get started with this. The nice part with running everything, in ROS is that you can either do C++, but many more students are now more comfortable with Python. You can use Python too. So both languages work.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay, please don't hesitate to ask whenever you have any questions. We are here for you. All right, so let's look at how do we avoid crashing and basically running these reactive planning algorithms. So essentially, we want to learn how to drive this car in a track, first of all, and follow this track along. And you can notice that this track is mostly a closed track, like it's a closed loop over here, but it's also very smoothly and very efficiently navigating these obstacles without any map over here, right? So it's not just following the wall over here, it is really trying to do something slightly smarter than that. And this is an example that I showed before. You can just see this vehicle is navigating all these obstacles.
Yeah, keep going.
And people can jump in front of it, dynamic obstacles, there's no problem with that. It does not know where the obstacles are a priori. It is just a reactive algorithm. And so we want to figure out how do we get that level of performance without a map. So we start with basically the sensors that are on the AVs. Obviously, production AVs have a lot of different sensors. That's one of the largest cost of the autonomous vehicle besides the vehicle itself. But that, there are different types of sensors, and the reason is that you want to have different modalities of complementary sensing and at different ranges. And on the F110, the one sensor that we will focus on today is the planar LiDAR. And the planar LiDAR is essentially like just a 2D LiDAR. It's a single beam that is just scanning the world at a fixed height, like that, right? So it's a relatively low cost. I would just put relatively in quotes over here. But it allows you to scan anywhere from 4 meters or 10 meters. And then this one can go up to 30 meters. And give you, so here you can see even in the simulator, we can scan and capture the walls over here. As long as you're on a flat surface, you're fine with a 2D LiDAR, right? So when you work with a laser scanner, it's essentially just estimating the distance by looking at the transmission and the reflection of that light. And it is capturing that very efficiently. So it's essentially shooting a ray of light, getting the reflection, shooting a ray of light, getting a reflection, shooting a ray of light, and doing that many times a second. And so this can basically give you, say, about a 270 degree coverage, and be able to capture that at about 20 frames per second. So in the robot operating system, which is basically the software framework that we are running over here, we are able to capture these distances or these ranges from across different angles over here, right? So and this is essentially every 20 hertz, we're able to get a whole array of distances of what's around us in the 270 degree range in front of us. So this is an example, a simplified example of what the car would see in a certain snapshot. And now we want to figure out where should the car go? And you know, so maybe one thing, so infinity is basically saying that there's no obstacle. As far as the range of the vehicle, the laser scanner goes, we haven't got a bounce back. You know, we sent the signal out and nothing reflected back. So that's just saying that, hey, that's open, that's open. So maybe we should just pick one of these infinities and just go there, because that's the furthest distance. And but what might be wrong with choosing that? So these scans are happening at a very fine angle, right? So it is going through, say about half a degree angles like that. So the vehicle has a certain, width over here, but the scans are at a much finer, scan distance. So even though you have an infinity there at that particular point, next to that, you have very close distances of about 3 meters. So you have to sort of figure out, I'm not going to be able to fit through that narrow gap. So maybe I should pick, something like, I need to have at least a bunch of, far enough scans. And what is far enough? So say I have some distance threshold T, let's say 5 meters. And I want to say I want to have at least, three of these scans that are, at least 5 meters away. And that says, okay, there's a good gap over there. And so essentially we are trying to follow the gap and just go where there is a place to proceed. We're going to proceed through that part over there. And there's another gap over there, but we'll just say, let's take the biggest gap that we can find and just be greedy in that manner, right? So we're going to fix this follow the gap algorithm. It's so simple that it's just going to follow the biggest gap and the car should go in that direction. But this is a naive algorithm in the sense that, it doesn't always work. Like in this example over here, if I have these obstacles, this vehicle is, can detect within this threshold over here, within the blue circle. And say it says, hey, there is a gap in front of me. That's the midpoint of the gap. I'm going to follow the gap and go there. But the vehicle is going to hit the corner, the edge of this obstacle right here, because it doesn't take into account like the affordances that it has to have. And so just seeking out the largest gap is might be fine for holonomic robots that can actually just move 90 degrees left or right, and they don't have to have a kind of a smooth spline movement. But if it's non-holonomic, it's fine as long as the obstacles are very sparse and spread out. So you have a lot of space there, but we don't have that privilege, when we are racing in corridors or driving in even on the road. So this doesn't optimize for safety because it's a greedy algorithm, but it's the vehicle is still going to hit these objects. And because it doesn't consider the car's dimensions over here, right? And we have to, it's very hard dynamically to decide what this threshold T is and what this threshold D is in order to navigate through these obstacles. So we have a slightly more conservative variation to this very naive approach. And that's basically saying instead of first finding the furthest point, first find the closest point, right? Like, and find the nearest LiDAR point and say that's the nearest LiDAR point in red over there. And to put some affordances, you're going to have a safety bubble around that. And say, for example, in this case, if we have, for some radius, which is basically the width of the car or how much the car would be plus some navigation affordance over there. So any of the LiDAR scan points that are, within that range of that radius over there, we're going to basically zero them all out over there. And so essentially, we're just going to say that that's a no-go. Don't go in that direction. But all the other points, we are now going to start to consider as free space. And now we're just going to follow the max gap. So the max gap is generally in the direction over here, somewhere along this direction, right? So, and we could go whether in the middle of that max gap, we could find what is the best point in that and then follow through that, right? So essentially we are again going back to follow the gap, but now we have eliminated essentially we taken like a conservative first step. And of course, now the thing is that, if you try to just implement follow the gap, the vehicle is going to constantly keep measuring and it's just going to keep shaking and oscillating over there. And it's not going to be able to do that smoothly at a good enough speed. So then you just add, you know, on top of that, essentially saying that, well, if the obstacle is about 3 to 4 meters away, then we just keep a steady speed or use a piecewise, you know, linear speed gradient to say that if obstacles are this far away, then we are at least at this speed. If they're much further away, we can increase our speed and only decrease your change your speed when obstacles are within a certain threshold.